recording. Give a quick overview of some of the stuff that we've done as part of the Fedora work to standardize booting systems, Linux ARM systems, specifically ARMv7, because you know that ARMv8 evil nasty UEFI crap.
It just works apparently.
Apparently,
mm-hmm.
After you know, a bazillion man hours of work, it just works.
But it
magic.
Works. Just magic. One day you will get also you have this lot of man hours done. So
So many years ago, when we first started down the road of booting Fedora on ARM, we had this wonderful concept of things we needed. You needed to know things like address location, memory address locations, because the kernel had to be loaded to specific memory addresses, and there's no way to refer to them by anything except a hexadecimal memory location. You'd have to wrap the kernel in McImage because that was the way it worked, and you'd have to wrap the NetRamFS. You would need to know different options for different boards. So TI stuff bootloaded to location 8000000, and
80,000 at the end.
And then Tegra was.
I had a feeling he was just here to heckle you.
No, yeah. I promise not.
Whatever, John. But yeah, you had to know intimate information about the particular system that you're booting on. You'd have to know that I need to pass this particular argument on the boot command line so that it doesn't try to bring up video because that doesn't work on this board or whatever it was. It was really, really messy. So you'd have a boot.scr file, and this is a very, very simple boot.scr file where you set the environment with some boot args, say the console is this, the root is here, root way, panic if nothing happens, and then you tell load the kernel from MMC device 0 to this location, this file. And the same for the NetRamFS. And then
and if you panic, you may get no output, because there's no serial port, so
it literally dealt with one device is where you get to tell it how much VM it has.
What works on one board doesn't work on another, because the one you've been working on had 512 megaram, this one has 256, and you're trying to load to a non-existent address. It was really, really messy, and as an end user, you don't need to know that I need to load these. You shouldn't want to know, you shouldn't care.
Could you summarize the situation in three words or less? Qt embedded hacks. I'm trying to.
No. Qt embedded nonsense hacks.
Oh, nonsense.
Qt embedded nonsense hacks were related.
All right. So,
it was a mess.
I don't have to say anything.
To get a system to boot in this old format was a complete nut of mess. And then we wrote, Brendan Cunnerboy, who is not here, wrote a tool called ARMboot Config, which attempted to do fancy things like detect, it would spit out a boot SCR that was about 1,000 lines long, and it would attempt to detect that, this is a TI system, and it's this, and so it uses these addresses.
Double shell,
it worked, it was a nice
stopgap fix.
Yeah, it gave you a menu, but it was really, really ugly and convoluted. And you'd have to run McImage on everything, so you need to know the memory locations of where you're gonna load your kernel, because you need to tell McImage the kernel needs to go here. So you can't even a kernel build time, you couldn't run McImage as part of the build, because different kernels needed to load the kernel, different boards needed to load the kernel into different locations. So you'd have to do it at install time, and we were getting lots and lots of just messy things trying to deal with all of it. And then you try to integrate tell anaconda, you need to be able to detect that you're running on a panda board, so So you need to set up these things, or you're running on a high bank and you need to use these locations and do this. And it was really bad. So we kind of went for a standard. And the standard we went with was SysLinux, Pixie Linux, EXT Linux, the SysLinux standard for booting. Main reason was when Calzada implemented Pixie support in U-boot, they stole, well not stole, but they borrowed all the formatting for Pixie Linux. The config file, so they taught U-boot to read a config file, they taught it to be able to boot the kernel and load the NitRamFS and pass all the options without actually having to know all that details yourself. And so we were able to extend that quite easily to boot from things other than Pixie booting. So a snippet of an EXT Linux config file is a label, a kernel. We added to the standard, it's like a pseudo thing, FTD dir, uboot, and the way that Calzada had implemented it, there's an FTD option which you can use, but it loads a specific DTP file, the device tree file. Passing a FTD dir entry says, here's where you can go find the device tree files, and it relies on uboot to know, I'm on this system, and this system needs a particular, I need this file. So it will look in that directory and load the file that it needs. And then you append your boot options, your init RD, and that's it. And from an end user perspective, it's much simpler. And when you actually boot a system that has this defined, you get a menu. And the menu at the moment is quite rudimentary. You get 1, 2, 3, 4. And by default, it'll boot 1. And if you want anything else, you've got to hit 2 and enter, or 3 and enter, rather than having, like arrow key support, which is something that U-boot has all that features. It's just not wired up. At some point, we could make it even better by enabling, you push the arrow key and hit enter on the kernel that you want. But that's from one of my one boards, the boot entry. It's pretty simple. So to get all of it implemented, we use the existing sysboot and Pixie support and U-boot. We standardized a bunch of config options. So one of the big issues was some U-boots would have FAT support, some would have EXT Linux, they'd be able to read EXT file systems, some would have no file systems, they would, there was a lot of inconsistency between builds of U-boot as to what it would work and what you had to do to get it to work. We standardized the boot options, and bingo, it worked. So I'm going to, if I can get the,
good.
I've got it all open. I just need to make it more visible. I was just going to go through some of the way that it's implemented, so that you can see how it's actually not really that hard.
Even I can do it.
Control plus
for this.
I always use Vim.
Control Shift plus?
No. Maybe Cake sucks. I normally use Vim, and I just like, I'll use Cake to make it pretty.
Which editor is this? Forms and Colors.
I have everything pretty small. Most people look at my laptop and can't read anything on it.
As long as you can.
Let's go a bit bigger.
And the dog's still lazy.
Dan
resembles that. Oh, you want that?
So, the first thing that we got into, that I got into U-boot, was this file called config distro defaults. All it does is it defines a bunch of default things. We define that we want the Pixie boot options and to be able to set the gateway, the host name, DNS, boot file, etc. We define some pixie options. We say that we want to have FTD support for the device tree because that's what everything uses today and it is awesome.
It's great. On 32-bit, it's wonderful.
Support
on 64-bit too, don't you?
Yeah, in here there's the command boot I, which the AR64 uses command boot, it uses the boot I command instead of boot Z to boot. For whatever reason, they decided to do it slightly different. We use boot Z.
Standard, like they added their own.
Yeah, define DHCP, ELF, the file systems we want.
Network.
Basic network, we have the pixie command, we can do command line editing. So when a board decides to support the standard, all they have to do is include this header, and then they get all of this stuff that we want defined.
Yep. See, you don't have XFS as the file system. Is that
there is no XFS support in U-boot.
Upstream.
That's if somebody's written it, I'm not aware of it. I have asked somebody internally to Red Hat to write it, and she was supposed to be, but I need to follow up and find out if
she took a poke at it.
I think she just kind of got distracted and did other things. So, I mean, we would add XFS if it existed.
On the other hand, it's still pretty standard in every install I've seen, you have a separate boot.
Ultimately, you could have an EXT boot and then run.
So,
and we've tested it, and in fact, the server scheme on ARM has a XFS root file system as the standard server.
You have an EXT4 boot file system, and I did a pixie install in Fedora 22 of the server. I got an EXT4 boot partition, XFS root.
You're still going to want that because you're going to have like an encrypted volume or something. You're still going to want that separate.
Yeah. So then once a board does that, we then have the distro boot command header, which defines the default boot commands. The way I actually ended up getting this into upstream U-boot was Stephen Warren, one of the NVIDIA developers, somehow had heard about the work I'd been trying to do in standardizing it, and he saw it and he's like, "This is awesome, we need to get this everywhere." And he kind of helped, I submitted patches and I wasn't getting feedback, and he helped to push it through and get it accepted into upstream. He ported all of the Tegra boards to use it. When all the Owner stuff landed upstream, they supported it by default. So slowly the IMX6 stuff is getting ported over to it. It's in a bit of a mess because every vendor that puts a new IMX6 board upstream in U-boot, they do a lot of stuff just slightly different. And so there's kind of some ongoing work there to make things more consistent and standard.
I've submitted about a number of series that equate to about 30 patches that have standardized a bunch of that stuff.
Yeah.
There's still a bit more work to do there, but IMX maintainer, like the IMX maintainer for, like the core maintainer, is very happy to accept that those changes. So we're getting there.
It's getting there slowly. And other people have taken stuff, like there's the ifdef config sandbox, which is that U-boot has this sandbox feature where you can build it and run U-boot as an application on the x86 system, and it's like a testing thing. They've implemented full support for it so that you can go through and test it in that environment. It required some slightly different config options to be set up. If the device is, and a lot of this is, if the device has, they've set config command MMC, so if the device config says, we have an MMC device, it then enables the ability to boot from the MMC. And if it has, SATA, it enables the SATA stuff to be booted, and same for SCSI. Weirdly, different vendors have done strange things over the years, and it's taken like 3 or 4 years to try and unravel a lot of it. some like Marvell's devices that have SATA, they put it, they implemented it as the IDE command. In the high bank, they implemented the SATA support as a SCSI command. And some people implemented the SATA support as a SATA command. They're all basically the same thing, and they're mostly using the same code with some slight tweaks, but so that's why there's, you know, command IDE. I don't think you'd find an IDE device attached to an ARM system anywhere today, but
not an ARMv7 system.
An ARMv7, yeah, V5 you will, but
with all those GPIO lines, it's possible.
It's possible, but
shush.
You know, by default implemented Pixie boot support so that, you know, any system that you get will, you know, at the least, you know, at the moment it's kind of a little not user friendly in that you can't redefine the boot order easily. It's pretty much hard coded that, you know, we've got like MMC, SATA, and then Pixie last, and you can't really easily.
And again, that's a bit board dependent.
And it's a little bit board dependent. Ideally, you know, in an ideal world would make it so that like a BIOS or, you know, UEFI, you can quite easily redefine the boot order on the fly, or, you know, you say I want to boot from USB just this one time. At the moment, to boot from USB, you've got to type a couple of commands. So it's not the most user-friendly, but it's getting there.
Yeah, then mm-hmm. You prove some of us wrong.
But can we build UEFI as a payload for U-boot?
Probably. I mean, there is a grub payload for U-boot.
It's been done. Someone's done it, actually. Yeah. They did that in Linaro originally as like the hack to kind of figure some of this stuff out.
So and there was a series of patches just recently that enables you to build U-boot as a UEFI application.
Like reverse. You boot which has board support.
Mm-hmm.
U-boot will load UEFI as payload, and then we have one standard interface.
So that in theory has been done. It's something that we, as the Fedora project doing ARMv7, aren't really that interested in.
Okay.
In fairness, Paul just reminded me, I thought I destroyed that brain cell. Actually, I have done this on V8 when we got the HP hardware.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, I guess I could talk about it now. We actually sort of convinced HP, they're just shipping it now. Their V8 hardware, I know it's V8, but they're shipping a new firmware that has UEFI in it, or U-boot, and it, you switch based on whether you want to boot a Red Hat OS or not. That was built originally, the hack was put together by me and a couple of other people doing something nasty like that. The point is, you proved me wrong here, because I thought this would never work out, the whole trying to clean it up.
It's
and just by being stubborn and pushing it, you've actually...
I'm pretty stubborn and big-headed when I want to be.
And ultimately, having John Masters in a talk in front of a whole bunch of people admit that he was wrong was worth it.
Yeah,
I'm
really I was wrong, actually.
It's...
Dennis is
we can end up the answer for pretty goddamn quickly.
I mean, it's not.
Let's
it,
do it.
It's not perfect, but and yet some of the issues that we hit, we still have, issues like putting U-boot onto the system, and that's not anything we can control. Most of that is vendors are being lazy, and cheap.
Yeah.
And you know, rather than putting, you know, spending a dollar and putting a meg of NAS flash or Spy flash or whatever on the board.
We had this with the 96 ports.
Yeah.
The consumer spec, it's still not a requirement that you have.
Yeah.
I argued this because I've helped write both specs. I argued for weeks that there'd be a requirement you have to have a Spy flash for this purpose,
mm-hmm.
right?
Well, and there's a whole bunch of other issues with the consumer edition of the board.
Yeah.
Like, they don't have, okay, if you're using it as a consumer device, to say develop a set-top box or a mobile phone or something like that, yeah, you probably don't want wired internet necessarily on it, and you don't need a serial console and stuff like that. But the fact of the matter is, it's a development board aimed to enable development, and so the fact that they don't have pinged out, and in fact the TTL is a non-standard 1.8 volt compared to every other device out there. The fact that they don't have wired Ethernet on board, while it's a minor inconvenience when you use USB, it actually makes it as a device a whole lot unusable as a development environment.
But in this, so to come back to the bootloader thing, with the, at least with the enterprise boards, we made it a requirement for every system, and I'm going to try to go back and do it the same for the consumer stuff for this reason, because we will see you boot on V8, we will see this stuff happen on the internet side, and we do need to make sure people understand, put a small, I don't care how nasty it is, something that's persistent that you can keep a bootloader independent of having the OS show.
I mean, if as long as the vendor, when they build a U-boot, they follow this, it's really easy for us to support.
And I mean, even better if we didn't have to ship.
If we only had to ship, you know, one
U-boot binary.
One, yeah.
Yeah.
But
ideally,
we don't ship any U-boot binaries. The vendors, you know, ship it and it supports a standard and it just works. But the reality is that most of them don't ship anywhere to put it, so there's no way they're shipping a binary.
One of the other interesting side effects of this, when Dennis first proposed the patches to upstream, there was massive pushback from the upstream U-boot community. Mm. And it
wasn't until Stephen got behind it.
I mean, there was a bunch of backwards and forwards, and eventually when Stephen picked it up, it was finally reluctantly accepted as an optional feature. Now
they're talking about it as a default.
In the vast majority of cases, when companies submit patches, the general response from some of the core maintainers is, why the hell are you doing that? Why don't you use distro support?
Right.
And so it's gone from something where over our dead body, is that ever going to be accepted, where people are going, actually, it generally works pretty well, and Debian has adopted it as a distro.
Kind of sitting on the fence. They're like, we don't want to break anything that exists, so we want to support the other stuff, but in theory, it's a really good idea when against it.
So the Debian guys are behind it.
Debian guys are full behind it. They'll inherit that through Debian.
In theory.
But we pushed and were the first to actively use the multi SoC kernel support, and you know that hurt us quite a bit in terms of a bunch of support and pain and everything. But now you know Debian's using that quite default as well, and so I mean we're sort of led by example, and we've endured a whole bunch of pain as a result of that. But now we're in a situation where it's amazing the number of devices where we just like. All the all-winner stuff, we just build all the all-winner U-boots. And we've had a number of people email voice or pop up on IRC and went, hey, I've got this random device in a lot of cases that I've never bloody well heard of. And they've just gone, we plug Fedora in and it's booted and it's worked.
So what would be good actually is if looking to the future, I'm sorry to keep giving random stuff, but no, not that sorry. If you have a one reference, when myself and others are going and meeting with some of these guys, and we're talking mostly server, but they're also saying, hey, we're building this embedded board in the future, it's going to be really cheap.
Yep.
It'd be nice to be able to tell them, look, servers, everyone knows what I'm pushing, but if you're building an embedded board, make sure it adheres to this. So do you have a single reference that we can find?
There is a documentation file in the U-boot sources that says how to implement it.
Yeah.
Okay. U-boot's actually pretty good about that, but realistically, what you do is, this is the Tegra common file which defines all the standard things
Tegra as an example.
Across the bottom. So they've got at the bottom here, if not defined, config SPL build, so if they're not building the SPL, include the config distro defaults header. So when they're building the uboot.bin file, include the config distro defaults in the common post, which is things that happen post loading and setting the system up. You know, here they're defining like setting up a USB keyboard and detector keyboard for the AC100 and all that kind of stuff. Some Chrome OS things. So you need to, they've got the mem layout which is defined on a per board basis.
We tried to standardize the memory map on V8, or I did, but every vendor said not a chance of that.
I'm just trying to remember where it actually is. But you,
you just have to pick your bus for that.
Where is that? And here they're including one file, which is the. They're defining the boot device target, so they've got MMC1, MMC0, so this is defining the boot order, USB, so you can plug a USB drive into the Tegra, Pixie, and then as a really last fallback, the old DHCP method, which we probably should just really remove that from all of this, it's not totally necessary. They're including the config distro boot command file, and then in the there's a boot extra nvarx, they're just taking the config extra n settings. This boot end is a variable that's picked up from the distro boot command, and that's it. That's all that's needed in the board side to take it. Then in the specific board implementation, they have a little section that says, you know, they're defining the mem layout settings to say, you know, the script ADDR variable is this location, the Pixie file ADDR, and there's like four or five variables that have to be defined for it to all work. And as long as you define those variables, it just works. And it hides completely from the end user then the need to worry about memory addresses that was such a pain in our butt at the start.
Nice.
I think probably from your point of view, there is section in the README file in the uBoot source, and there is a number of commits where vendors have gone convert to generic uBoot in the Git, and so they can actually go and see what various different SOCs have done.
There's a README.distro file.
Yeah, that's the one.
And
yeah.
It goes through and tells you the basics of it, how the menu stuff works, how to implement it, what you need. It's, you know, not a huge document, but you know, it's 389 lines, but it tells you most of what you need to do, and all you need to do is look at, you know, one or two of the boards and see, okay, this is how they've done it, and it's really easy.
There's no reason not to tell people to do this. If you're not building a server, then do it this way.
If you want to support UEFI, this is the way you should support UEFI.
If you're not going to support UEFI and ACPI, do this,
and I mean,
this would be the only other way that we will support you.
Then I will modify the rhetoric.
I mean, ultimately, the fact of the matter is there are a number of very useful use cases for UEFI. Whether you like it or not.
Yeah, agreed.
And so, if they're going to use uBoot, if they can do this, it makes our life easy, because similar to UEFI, there is very little that we need to do to export.
In this instance, the ext-lines config file, or you know, like when you Pixie boot, your Pixie config is the API between the firmware and the system loading. And we're saying like Anaconda is going to write out the config file that's right. As long as you read and pass that file, it's gonna boot and it's gonna work. And it could definitely be prettier. I mean, on the ONS stuff, if you've got it plugged in, you get uBoot output on your screen, if you've got a screen plugged in and USB keyboard, you get the output, you can select it just like a desktop system. The Tegra stuff is not quite there. It's only putting it on the serial console, but it wouldn't take much to get it to output to video as well. There's a lot of improvements that could be done. It could be made more user friendly so that you can just use arrow keys rather than typing 1, 2, or 3, depending on which boot option you got. So that is the file, and I have here
good books.
Just for kids, I'm not sure if you'll be able to see this too well. But yeah, we love the SPL. This card doesn't actually have anything to boot, so it's going to go through and say, oh, we can't boot. But it's trying to actually pixie boot at the moment, but it's not plugged into the network. So
good luck with that.
Yeah. So I mean, the environment is a little ugly looking here, but a typical end user doesn't need to know any of that. It still supports all the old, like if you really want to use a boot.scr file and do the old ugly stuff, we haven't removed that support. We're just saying the default and the first thing it's going to try is, you know, ext Linux, and you know that's the way that it should be done. You know, like here we have the FTD file defined, so that's what uBoot appends to the variable that's in the FTD dir, and it loads that file. So you get your DTB file loaded. So you know, like the uBoot itself, the files are standardized in what how they're named for the device tree files. uBoot itself knows what hardware it's running, it knows what device tree file it needs. The user should never need to know that. You know, we tell it, here's where you go find them, but you know, it's really simple. I probably should have put a OS on the MMC card rather than just uBoot, but it's pretty simple and straightforward, and all this stuff is hidden from the user. So it's taken us about 3 years to get to the point where most things support it. You know, when we first did it, I was carrying patches porting over like half a dozen different boards, or a dozen boards. Then like as all the Windows stuff got upstream, it just supported it by default. Tegra got ported upstream. I sent patches to port all the TI boards, and they rejected them because some of the boards they didn't want it supporting, so I've got to be a little more selective in that.
I think eventually it will overcome
that. Eventually I think they'll overcome that, but you know, it means something that's gone from, well, this is ugly and what are you doing this, and still from time to time. So one of the big things is, well, you need to run, you know, upstream, like you need to run McImage, you need to boot the wrapped kernel because, and the wrapped initramfs, because then we can verify that everything's right. And it's like, for the average user, they don't care. And having to actually wrap the kernel in initramfs is a confusing, convoluted extra step. And they're like, well, you can make the tools do it, but you know, you can't just then run Drekka, you know, I want to rebuild my initramfs and add a couple of extra modules, because you've then got to know, oh, I've got to wrap it and add these extra.
It adds something different for the people who use it, you know, PC or something else. They're going to be like, what the heck am I doing here?
And I mean, ultimately, we want as close as possible to the other architectures as possible.
What about the grub? Just aspirationally longer term.
There is actually a port of grub to uBoot,
yes,
as a uBoot application.
Yes.
The problem is that the way that it was done, it hard codes into the grub binary at build time, an address where it's going to load, which does not work across
multiple
systems.
But it's still in your locator code because it's got its own relocator. So that's not something that we should do relatively straightforward today.
Exactly.
It could be. And so we actually have...
Are you volunteering? Showing batch maybe.
I mean, we do have enabled the config API option, which enables the grub application to work.
It may be relatively simple to get that.
And maybe we could use grub, but it's just, you know, this was the path of least resistance.
Well, I mean buses, right? So this is a great standard to get to have the handoff, but you could then, just longer term, you could then look at having...
Longer term,
yeah, another
look at
layer,
having,
but
it
gets even closer.
Yeah,
to,
I mean, and absolutely, we look at over that.
Yeah.
I mean,
I'm still using this.
Yeah, no,
you need to load grub, which then people that know even closer to what they're
using.
But
I mean, this is almost
like a BIOS as opposed to grub. So,
yeah.
I mean,
that's what I'm saying.
Know,
this
got us to the ability to run multiple kernel versions and
yeah.
with very minimal
yeah.
effort,
yeah.
and
what
without that? Having to know the massive, massive code base that is grub.
One of the big things that's missing from it that I'd like to have is command line editing, so that you can, you know, if you need to add, you know, like enforcing equals zero, because for some reason you're hitting some SE Linux issue that is preventing you from booting, you have to put the SD card into a different system and edit the file and do it. There's no, it doesn't currently have.
We'll boot the last bit.
We just need to load it up and get that for
free. Yeah.
And every other feature.
Sure.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, which was what I was about to say.
Yeah.
I mean, if we had grub, but that problem just goes away.
Yeah. I killed, full disclosure, I killed the, well, it wasn't just me, but I strongly encourage the demise of the grub and UBoot project in Lenaro, just from a resourcing point of view, because we had that or some little bit of the 64, but there was still a lot of interest in you know, and those patches do exist, it probably wouldn't be a lot to get that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's definitely an option.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the bootloading and the stuff that we support today is a million times better than what we were looking at 2 years ago.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. We just say now it's even possible to do
yeah.
those next things.
So yeah, the vendors are slowly getting on board with it, and you know, upstream's getting on board with it, and they kind of, you know, when I first submitted I submitted the first patches and you know, had copyright Red Hat, people were kind of like, oh my god, it's end of the world. You know, like the UBoot people, they're like, Red Hat's contributing to UBoot?
It's not ECOS, what?
No, to Red Boot.
To yeah, and now, you know, Hans to Good is the maintainer of the all-winner tree. So yeah, there's quite a lot of Red Hat contribution going on into UBoot.
I mean, ultimately, even if we do get grub support, this is still needed and relevant
yeah.
and everything else. So
there's no reason this changes.
No.
You just maybe add something that it loads on top of it.
If anyone has any interest, there's a bunch of boards that still need boarding and
yeah.
send patches upstream.
Do you have a list of what these do?
Chromebook. And
yeah.
the Chromebook's a special case of hell.
Yeah, not part of the computer. That's not a beginner's.
No, I didn't say it wasn't hell. I said we had we have all the bits in place to basically a whole recipe to enable us to get to hell.
That sounds very interesting.
I'll
grab
the
Chromebook.
Any questions? I'm
going
to have a talk about
that.
And that actually is one of my questions. With the new Chromebooks with the new stuff.
Okay.
The
stuff
on the back.
Yeah.
Yeah. So those are being weird to get.
No, so
I thought you were saying the UBoot.
They are.
The UBoot runs upstream. The hard bit is getting UBoot into the right location so it can be loaded. And to make the best user experience, you need to pop it open and take the screw and completely rewrite the spy flash. But there is ways to.
So there's two ways of dealing
with
this.
Without
the Tegra hardware is sort of locked down with the Chrome OS bootloader, but they have in the SPI flash there is an area that you can write a quote unquote legacy bootloader to. But when you write that there, you take your UBoot, you wrap it in this stuff that makes it into a, I think it's a core boot file system image thing, and then you essentially DD that core boot file system's wrapped UBoot bootloader into the SPI flash at this flash address. Once you've got that, you hit something
Control L,
which boots legacy, which then enables you to boot Fedora and away you go.
But you have to push Control L every time you boot.
There's another setting for that. And actually, it's at least you can make it default to the legacy boot by default.
x86 is different when it comes to Chrome.
Don't they have the same settings for the?
I think there is possibly those settings hidden somewhere, but
yeah.
I mean,
it's not very well documented at all.
I mean, it took us some time to get out of various different people.
Yeah.
That there was this memory area that was read-write that we are able to write into,
yeah.
And that you don't just write the U-boot into there, but you basically have to wrap the U-boot with this stuff. So we know all the steps. We don't necessarily know the exact details of the steps to make it easy.
Okay.
So essentially, the plan is to have a script or even ship a pre-packaged art image that people can just
flash
it in.
Yeah.
At which point you'd be able to either shove in a USB stick or an SD card, and probably the internal eMMC, although I haven't even gone as far as looking at that.
Yeah.
And just boot Fedora.
Yeah.
Right. And with the all the Tegra K, Tegra K1 series and newer chipsets.
Yeah.
So.
It's consumer devices based on the.
Yeah. The Tegra, I think it's a Tegra K1, the Tegra 124, and a few other numbers that I don't remember offhand, but I think it's anything larger than 124,
yeah.
Ships with the Nuvo, with the decent graphics accelerator,
yeah.
It's now fully supported in the Nuvo driver.
Yeah, nice.
The firmware blobs that you need are now upstream in Linux firmware.
Yeah.
And there is a patch series, I think of 5 or 6 patches that's in the DRA net. And that's it. And that should give us fully accelerated GNOME shell on a Tegra kernel.
Yeah. Very excited about that, yeah.
Yeah. And a lot of people, including myself, are.
Yeah.
It's just now a matter of working out all that little bit of road to hell around the U-boot, core boot image stuff,
yeah.
And getting that process to a stage where we know it works,
yeah.
And we can do it reliably, because, you know, hitting Control L in the short term while we, you know, bribe people to tell us what,
yeah.
If there's a command that we can run in,
yeah.
in forget what Google calls it for, call boot or whatever,
yeah.
It is. They,
how this is this for payload and file queries?
Yeah. Anyway, so you'll get, other than a Control L on occasion when you boot,
yeah.
You should get an extremely usable, really nice Fedora ARM system.
Yeah. There's going to be a ton of people flying out.
Yeah.
Fedora ARM Chromebooks, so.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And the thing is that the Denver core, which is I think T132, is pin compatible, and which is AX64, is pin compatible with the K1 124 32-bit.
Yeah.
So in theory, it is possible to take a standard for a manufacturer to take their current shipping line of Chromebooks and swap out a 32-bit chip for a 64-bit chip, and that would even be more awesome, but I've not seen one of those on market yet. I've not seen any announcement about it, but there's no reason why it couldn't happen.
Yeah. One thing that just occurred to me is that what these vendors often have is some recovery tool, right? And I haven't looked at that particular system, but if there is some kind of download and recovery tool, that's going to be the thing that might know what magic address code to reset for the boot order.
In the case of Tegra, the recovery tool was Tegra RCM.
Okay.
It's fully open source and packaged in Fedora. But
they also have a USB recovery
mechanism and stuff like that.
They don't have anything else where there might be some blob.
Well, no, so the issue is using the what is it? Trusted platform.
Trusted execution environment.
No,
trusted.
No, Yeah, trust zones are technology.
Anyway, basically the thing that they designed to enforce DRM stuff.
Well, the trusted firmware, just the generic.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Yeah.
The trusted firmware is enabled on those boards.
Okay.
And so they're essentially locked down like you would lock down, say, a mobile phone.
Yeah.
The Exynos way of dealing with that, the unlocking of that lockdown, is the whole take out the board and do nasty things to it thing that you can work around. NVIDIA was nice enough that they enabled this area of writable flash to boot a legacy thing.
It's exactly the same. The bootloader stuff on the Tegra ARM Chromebooks is exactly the same as on the x86 ones. It uses the same depth charge payload and it has the same read-write legacy area. On the x86, the read-write legacy, they put a CBIOS BIOS in there so that you can just go and boot a Linux distro. But they left that completely empty in ARM ones. It's enabled by... I have one in my bag.
Has anybody dumped the firmware, looked at the other config space there, and just done a straight linear analysis of memory references
and
see what references
are?
That
would be the thing.
I don't have to know the capability personally of doing that.
We could do it. One of them landed in my office for a couple of hours.
We could raise that.
Yeah.
That's over.
Yep.
Nice work, Dennis. Thank you very much.